The Missing Wife and the Stone Fen Siamese. Written by Kate High, read by Charlotte Strevens. The moral right of the author has been asserted. Chapter 1. The creature leapt from the blackness of the sodden dyke, travelling at speed into the light. Momentarily startled, Clarice Beech hit the brake and at the same time dipped the headlights. The hare, landing on the single-lane track a few feet in front of her car, did not pause. Instead, with its front legs out, it pushed upwards, stretching its long hind limbs to jump again and reach the dyke on the opposite side of the track before disappearing back into the darkness. The elegance and coordinated grace of the creature stayed lodged in her mind for the remainder of the journey. Classes for the new term of Tuesday evening ceramics had begun in the third week of September. It was a 20-minute drive on unlit country lanes from the town of Castlewick in the Lincolnshire Wolds to Clarice's home. Now that British summertime had ended, dusk came early, and she always left and returned home in darkness. Often at the end of September, it felt that one foot was still planted in summer, with sunny days that drifted into mellow evenings. This year, it had been cold and autumnal from the beginning of that month, so now, 1 week into November and 6 into the term, the chill of winter had taken a firm hold. The class had been running for 11 years, mainly attracting people who worked during the day. The workshop size imposed a limit of 8 students. 6 of the current group had attended from the very beginning. As they'd attained a greater knowledge of techniques, their work had developed, and with friendships deepening over time, the small group had evolved to become tight-knit. Clarice marvelled at how well such an eclectic bunch had bonded. Their backgrounds and life experiences could not have been more different. There was an accountant, a tattooist, a mechanic, a shop worker, a solicitor, a teacher, a nurse, and a retired secretary. Their ages ranged from 35 to 74. The students shared their successes and failures. If, after firing, a piece came from the kiln with a crack, the disappointment was collective. Each was aware of the effort that had gone into its production, and there were often deadlines. The ceramics designated as gifts for birthdays, Christmas and weddings. If a piece failed in the firing, it would mean starting again. There was always banter and laughter during classes, as the group discussed family and work problems and caught up on what had occurred over the time since their last meeting. Tonight, the class was down by 1 student, Colin Compton-Smythe, a middle-aged accountant, one of the 6 who had signed up from the first class. He told Clarice he was unsure if ceramics would really suit him, but he'd give it a try for a term. Colin was short, slim, and, as befitted his profession, conservative in attire. On joining the class, he'd initially given the impression of being extremely shy. But over time, as his relationships with fellow students developed, and his assurance in producing top-quality ceramics increased, his confidence grew and he flourished. As he shed his reserve, Clarice had noticed changes in his appearance. In the first year, he'd abandoned his tie, and in the second, he had acquired a pair of jeans. The most significant transformation came after 3 years, when he'd replaced his regular conventional glasses with elegant Kingfisher blue frames. It was an act of rebellion, as if he'd suddenly decided he would no longer be invisible. Everyone in the group had met Colin's daughter, Emily. Over the years, she'd attended end-of-term social gatherings and parties. Clarice had watched her transformation from an 8-year-old schoolgirl to a 19-year-old university student. She'd inherited her father's shyness, but managed to put up a good front. Only the heightening of her facial colour, blushing, gave her away. Earlier in the day, Clarice had received a call from Emily confirming that her father had gone into Lincoln Hospital as arranged and would later undergo surgery for a bowel problem. After asking the girl to pass on her good wishes for a speedy recovery, Clarice had taken a get-well card to class. All the students wrote in it with messages designed to cheer. After signing and passing the card on, Jill, the retired secretary, had bitten her bottom lip, her face pinched with worry. "He will be okay, won't he?" she asked, addressing the class as a whole. "Course he will," Mickey, the town tattooist, reassured her. "Told me he didn't like the idea, but wanted to get it over with. He'll be right as rain in a couple of weeks." Knowing that Emily was staying at her father's house on the outskirts of Lincoln, Clarice intended to leave the card on his doorstep the following day, along with some flowers. She could pass them on to her dad on her next hospital visit. As she drove carefully in the darkness along the narrow lanes, her thoughts moved to Rick, hoping he might have beaten her home. As a detective inspector with the Lincoln police, her husband's working hours were not always predictable. Clarice generally ate her evening meal early and alone, leaving Rick's for him to warm up later. He had begun work on a new case related to an incident in a Lincoln nightclub over the previous weekend. An argument between two groups had flared, leading to a knife being produced and a fatality. Due to a trivial falling out, a man of 23 had lost his life. With his usual stoicism, Rick was now occupied with the minutiae of what had happened in the minutes leading up to the death. The area in a hallway near the toilets where the altercation had occurred was not covered by the club's CCTV, and there were conflicting accounts of who had been carrying the knife and had inflicted the fatal wound to penetrate the heart. Driving out of the last of the winding lanes, Clarice came to a main unlit carriageway. Hidden by the darkness of the late evening, agricultural fields and undulating hills flanked either side of the road. The beam from her car headlights pierced the blackness, and 10 minutes later, she reached an unmarked exit leading down to an incline onto a rough track. Following the curve of the bend, she saw the welcoming lights of home. Built in the 1850s and added to by various incumbents over the years, her cottage was surrounded by 3 acres of garden and a number of outbuildings, which included her ceramics workshop and a barn converted for rescue animals. Some years ago, Clarice had founded a charity called Castlewick Animal Welfare, known locally as CAW. The barn housed animals she fostered until they found permanent homes. She parked her blue Range Rover next to Rick's white BMW estate. That he was already at home lightened her spirits. Walking to the cottage, she pulled tight her heavy grey winter coat to keep out the whip of the wind and the cold night air, and caught the welcome smell of drifting wood smoke. Rick had put a match to the fire she'd laid that morning. Before she reached the door, the sounds of joyful yelping came from the dogs. The noise of the car engine, signalling her arrival, had sent them into welcome mode. The door opened, allowing Blue, a sturdy Labrador cross, Black with a white chest, and Jazz, a smaller, rough-coated brown dog with a long body and short legs, to run out to greet her. Blue, as usual, carried a present clamped in her mouth, a battered tennis ball. Jazz, close behind, without a gift, wiggled her body while swinging her long tail. Behind the Welcome Home Committee, filling the doorframe, blocking out the light, stood Rick. At 6'4", tall, solid and broad, he had a height advantage of 3 inches over his wife. "Good class?" he asked when the dogs had calmed, allowing Clarice to get inside. "Not bad," she said, before telling him about Colin's absence and the reason for it. "Was it something that was expected?" "He knew he had to go in," Clarice said. "Yesterday he had lots of tests, and today he's having the surgery, but he seemed unfazed by it." Rick poured 2 glasses of South African Shiraz, and he and Clarice drifted into the sitting room, followed by the dogs, to the welcoming warmth of the open fire. In her childhood, this space had been 2 smaller rooms. After inheriting the property from her mother, she had changed it to make it into 1 long room, with windows now covered by heavy red drapes at the far end. On the walls were large, colourful framed posters of jazz and blues musicians, with the room lit by several table lamps and the glow from the fire. Clarice took up her usual spot, reclining on the sofa in front of the hearth, while Rick sat at an angle in a nearby armchair. Toots, a long grey cat, stretched along the back of the sofa, lifting her head to acknowledge their arrival. The dogs spread themselves on the floor in front of the open fire, and as the group relaxed, other cats wandered in to join them. "Sandra left a note," Rick said. "She and Bob left about 7. They fed and watered all the cats in the barn." "Great," Clarice smiled, wondering how she'd manage without the support of their friends Bob and Sandra, who acted as volunteers for her rescue charity. "Tell me about your day. Anyone admitted to the stabbing?"
"No."
Rick stretched his long legs out as he talked.
"We have footage from the CCTV in the club and outside, just not the area where the stabbing took place. We can identify each individual involved and have 14 witness statements, including everyone in the hallway where the victim died. We've narrowed it down to 2 possible suspects."
"What about fingerprints on the knife?"
"We don't have it. Whoever used it took it away."
Rick was pensive.
"Also, everyone involved had the victim's blood on their clothing. We'll need to work out from the blood spatters who was the nearest to the victim at the moment he was stabbed."
"What was the argument about?"
"Bearing in mind they were all half cut, it comes down to one bloke accidentally knocking someone's arm, causing him to spill his drink."
Rick raised his eyes.
"It progressed from swearing and name-calling to the 2 men and their friends moving away from the bar area to the corridor outside the toilets."
"Unbelievable," Clarice said. 23, and his whole life ahead of him.
And a pregnant girlfriend."
"No, that's awful."
"It is pretty depressing."
The ringing of the phone cut into the conversation.
"Bit late."
Rick looked at his watch.
"It's probably for me. More problems.
I'll get it." Clarice lifted Big Bill, a large, friendly ginger cat, from her lap.
"Hi, Clarice. It's Emily, Colin's daughter from class. I'm sorry to phone so late."
"Emily," Clarice said with surprise, glancing at Rick, who, realizing the call was not for him, sat back in his chair, relieved.
"How did Colin's operation go? Well, I hope."
There was a long silence before Emily responded. Clarice could tell that she was struggling to keep calm.
"It seemed okay," she said. "But Dad was in theatre a lot longer than they said he'd be. When he came out, I was allowed to sit with him for a while."
Clarice waited to hear what was coming, aware from the tone of Emily's voice that it would not be good news.
"He didn't come round while I was there, and the staff told me to go home and get some sleep, to go back tomorrow."
"So you went home?" Clarice asked gently.
"Eventually. I didn't want to leave him alone."
Emily stopped abruptly. Again, Clarice waited.
"I'd only been home 10 minutes when they phoned to tell me that Dad had died. I wish I hadn't left him."
Her voice was a wail. Clarice remembered Emily's age, and her mind flicked momentarily to the 23-year-old man murdered in the nightclub. Colin's daughter was younger, only 19, studying social history at Nottingham University. Being young was no protection against bad things happening.
"It isn't your fault, Emily," Clarice said.
"The staff at the hospital would have believed that the operation had gone well. They wouldn't have suggested you go home if they thought he wasn't going to pull through." "They said he had a heart attack. The operation was obviously too stressful."
"I'm so sorry," Clarice said. She waited for Emily's sobs to subside before she continued.
"Are you alone? Is there someone with you?" "I've sent Jake, my boyfriend, a text. He's in Nottingham, but I think he'll phone and come over when he picks the message up."
"Are you going to be okay until he arrives?"
"Yes."
Emily's voice trailed away.
"I have to phone my mum. She lives in France. She and Dad are divorced. And then my grandfather, Dad's father. Jake should have got back to me by then. I'll be fine."
Later, after having done her last check of the rescue cats in the barn, Clarice walked the dogs around the garden with Rick, thinking about poor Colin's unexpected death. "Are you worried about her?" Rick asked.
"Yes," Clarice said. "The poor girl is in shock. I hope her boyfriend gets there quickly. She needs someone she loves and trusts to offer a shoulder to cry on. No one should be alone at a time like this. Chapter 2. The following morning, low grey clouds lay like a dirty, rumpled duvet over the fields and hills, heavy with the threat of rain. Rick and Clarice walked the dogs around the outer boundary of the garden. Blue, with a new treasure, a short, stout stick clamped in her jaw, oozed joy, while Jazz ran in circles around them. The morning walk was always her favourite of the day. After doing 3 laps of the boundary, Clarice kissed Rick goodbye and watched as his car disappeared to make its way onto Long Road. Going back into the house, she fed the animals and breakfasted on toast with honey and a cup of tea before returning outside to cross the garden to the cat barn. The barn, divided into 3 sections, allowed Clarice to separate or isolate animals when necessary. During the spring and summer, the number of cats and kittens were high, but there had been a good home visits rate, with animals finding new homes. Also, Clarice had recruited 4 new foster carers in and around Castlewick. The downside to entrusting a cat to an ardent cat lover was that they invariably fell in love with the first one they looked after, and when a prospective adopter was found, could not bear to be parted from it. The upside was that although Clarice lost a foster carer, the cat found its perfect loving home. The upsurge in rehoming and the extra foster homes meant that there were currently only 10 feline residents in the barn. Walking across the garden, Clarice heard the cry from the most recent of these, an apricot-coloured Persian. Entering the barn, she found that Sassy, having pushed his bedding around the floor, was sitting in the centre of the room emitting a loud, croaky, indignant howl. The old cat was completely deaf and unaware that he was not alone. He appeared to be shouting at the wall. 3 days earlier, Clarice had received the type of call she dreaded. Sassy Boo, a 17-year-old cat, had been left behind when social services took her elderly owner into a nursing home. A neighbour had been tasked with feeding her and finding an animal rescue charity to take her. But, due to the animal's age, this had proved impossible. Clearly distressed, the neighbour had telephoned Clarice from a Lincoln veterinary practice, having taken Sassy Boo there to be put to sleep. One of the vet's nurses had given her Clarice's number. She was using the vet's telephone to ask if the charity might help. Clarice had taken Sassy Boo to be examined by her friend Jonathan Royal, the Castlewick vet. "You're a niffy old girl," Jonathan spoke gently to the cat. "Her teeth," Clarice said. "I noticed as soon as I picked her up."
"What do you know about her?"
"Not a lot. The neighbour told me the owner was 91. She'd had Sassy for 15 years. She's actually a sweetie." Clarice looked at the animal as she spoke. "But she has the grumpiest expression I've ever seen on a cat."
"Unfortunate name?"
Jonathan lifted his eyebrows. "Yes," Clarice grimaced. "And apparently the owner used to tie a small pink ribbon in a bow on top of her head." They stood silently, side by side, looking at the sour face. The belligerent eyes stared back as if to challenge them.
"Leave her with me," Jonathan smiled. "I'll check her over and sort out any problems with her teeth. You know I'll need to put her under."
Clarice nodded. "I'll come back later." She was aware that anaesthetic with an elderly animal carried risks, but there was no other option. If the cat was in discomfort with rotten teeth, her quality of life would be affected. When she'd returned to the surgery, a sleepy Sassy Boo had been brought into the consulting room in her travel basket. Jonathan, short and sturdy, with a mass of curly white hair, stood in his regular pose, arms folded, head angled to one side.
"She's still a bit dopey," he said.
"How many—" Clarice began.
"Ask," Jonathan interrupted with a raised index finger.
"Not how many teeth I have removed, but rather how many I've left in." "How many have you left in?" Clarice complied.
4.
"They were bad."
"Awful," Jonathan agreed.
"I could practically pull them out with my fingers. They must have been causing her a lot of irritation. And I think I've discovered the reason for the grumpy face."
"Go on," Clarice said. "If you were a big butch boy,
How would you like to have to wear a pink ribbon and have everyone calling you a pretty girl?
She is a he.
He is a neutered tomcat. Carrying Sassy around the barn now, listening to his full-on purr, Clarice remembered the conversation.
You may have the grumpiest face, but you also have the loudest purr.
She scratched behind his ears. From now on, I'll call you Sassy and we can forget the boo and the ribbons. Sassy drooled with delight. You do kick up when you're left alone, even though you have your own hiding box. Clarice put the cat down thoughtfully. I imagine your owner was with you for most of the day. Sassy stopped purring and stared disgruntled as Clarice headed to the door. Don't worry, sweetheart. I'll be back, she said quietly. And just remember to work your magic on the big man I bring in later. Back at the house, she left a note for Bob and Sandra telling them she would be visiting Emily and would be back later. Snug, in her chunky, waterproof dog-walking jacket, she pulled on a matching tan-coloured woolen hat, tucking her shoulder-length auburn hair inside. Outside, the grass was wet, the rain that had threatened earlier coming down in a fine drizzle. It was almost 8:30 a.m. when she reached the outskirts of Lincoln. She'd looked at the flowers in her garden and judged the wind-battered autumn perennials not good enough to give as a gift. She drove directly to a florist near Colin's home, and from a large selection chose a bouquet of bright yellow chrysanthemums and white carnations. After putting them on the front seat to join the card expressing her sympathy, she made her way through the maze of streets in the Nettleham area to reach Colin's bungalow. Over the years, Colin had gone from being just another of her adult students to becoming a good friend. He'd spoken so often of his daughter, an only child. He and Emily had been in touch daily with phone calls or texts, and she frequently visited him for Sunday lunch. Clarice had thought of their closeness as a joy for Colin, but with his sudden death, his being such a big part of her life would only deepen the sense of loss for Emily. Turning into the quiet cul-de-sac, she drove slowly between the two rows of bungalows facing one another across a narrow road. Built within the new millennium, they were outwardly smart and well-maintained. The gardens to the front of each property already looked barren in the onset of early winter. Trees had shed their leaves, with those remaining a variety of colours on a theme of brown and gold. The ground below the trees was for the most part clear, suggesting a tidy neighbourhood. As she drove towards the end of the cul-de-sac, Clarice remembered her last visit in May. She'd brought ceramic plates fired in the college kiln for Colin and stayed for a cup of tea. She recollected an orderly house, Colin's output of dishes, plates and vases adorning his hallway and sitting room. He'd had a love of roses and had decorated many of his plates with abstract red shapes resembling flowers. Quite an achievement, given that red glazes were notoriously difficult to fire successfully. She parked outside number 72 and picked up the flowers and card. The curtains were closed, and she imagined that Emily and Jake, after a late night of conversation, were having a lie-in. Tucking the card under the flowers to one side of the porch, she slipped quietly back down the path.
Clarice!
Emily's voice reached her as she left the garden. Chapter 3 Clarice turned to retrace her steps. I didn't want to bother you, she said. Emily was pretty, petite and slim. Clarice thought of a delicate, spindly whippet. She understandably did not look her best today. She'd half emerged from behind the door, wearing creased pink pyjamas, her long brown hair scraped back into a ponytail, her skin pallid and eyes puffy. Is Jake still here?
He didn't make it.
Emily was blunt, not expanding with an explanation.
Come in, Clarice.
She held the door open.
And thanks for these.
She cradled the flowers in the crook of her arm as she led the way into the sitting room. The room had not changed since her last visit. Clarice looked at the plates and vases displayed on the sideboard and windowsill. Emily followed her gaze.
He so loved your classes.
Putting the flowers and card down on a table, Emily attempted a weak smile.
and I gained a whole new family in his classmates. He included me in all the social events.
He told me at the first class that he'd try ceramics for one term.
And then he was hooked, Clarice said.
Yes. I don't think he ever considered himself artistic or creative, but he was.
Emily's voice held a note of surprise. He just had to find a way to let it out, and ceramics did it for him. Emily nodded, a smile wobbling before she dissolved into tears.
I'm so sorry.
Clarice put an arm around her shoulders and waited as the younger woman, her hands now filled with tissues pressed against her face, sobbed loudly. When the tears were finally reduced to sniffling, she guided Emily to the sofa and sat down beside her.
I guess you didn't get any sleep last night, she said.
Emily shook her head.
I was wandering around the house. I couldn't settle.
She blew her nose and sniffed as if trying to regain her composure.
It's just so unfair. Dad was only 55. Grandpa, Dad's father, is still going strong in his mid-80s.
It isn't fair, Clarice said gently. But then, that's life.
Grandpa said that last night. He said Dad was too young.
Emily pondered.
I think he was crying, but I don't know. He isn't the type to cry.
If he's in his 80s, he'll have lost a lot of people, friends and family over the years. But Colin was his son, a special bond. Did your dad have siblings?
No.
Emily was calm now, twisting the tissues between her fingers.
He was an only child like me.
Me too, Clarice smiled. It has good points and bad. Emily nodded agreement.
Let me make you a cup of tea or coffee.
A cuppa would be great. Clarice followed her into the kitchen, encountering a sleek black cat in the hallway. Hello, you. She knelt as she spoke, watching as the cat pushed its head against her proffered hand.
That's Josephine, Emily said. Napoleon's on Dad's bed.
I've met them before. Siblings. I couldn't tell them apart.
They're best buddies, Emily said. I was 4 when Dad brought them home as kittens. So they're over 15 now.
10 minutes later, the two of them sat with steaming mugs of tea at a round, white formica table in the kitchen. Like other parts of the property, the kitchen, with its pine units and white wall tiles, looked pristine. 3 misshapen papier-mâché pigs of varying sizes squatted in a line on top of the fridge.
I made those for Dad, Emily pointed at the pigs, when I was at school.
So, Colin wasn't the only artist in the family, Clarice teased.
They're a bit rubbish, but I was only 7.
Your dad didn't think they were rubbish.
No,
Emily said, her voice serious, her eyes glassy with unshed tears.
What's happening about the funeral?
Clarice changed the subject.
Grandpa will organise it.
Emily brushed her hand across her face as she spoke, attempting to banish the tears.
The Compton-Smiths have a family plot at Sealsby Church. I know Grandpa would want him there, and he'll arrange a church service, though that's a bit awkward.
Colin wasn't religious.
No,
Emily grimaced.
I know you can have non-religious funerals, but that won't happen with Grandpa. I don't feel strong enough to fight him about it.
Is the family home near the village? Clarice asked.
It's quite close, about 5 miles away. Stone Fen Manor is on the edge of the fens, one of the last houses before the wash. It was built in 1890 on reclaimed land. A couple of 100 years before that, it would have been part of the wash. Dad described it as the end of the bloody world. He didn't mention it to you?
No, Clarice pondered. I can't remember him mentioning the house or anything about his family, apart from you. He loved to talk about you.
He must have bought the pants off everyone.
Emily's face suddenly lit up.
I could never have any secrets. Dad told the whole world about every aspect of my life. But then, I was a real daddy's girl.
He was so proud of you.
I know.
Emily nodded.
You're welcome to attend the funeral, and any of his friends from the class. I know some of them would have to get time off work, so they might not be able to come.
I'll drive down, Clarice smiled. And after I've put the word out to Colin's classmates, I expect there'll be others.
I would have been surprised if Dad had mentioned his father, or talked about his childhood,
Emily said.
It wasn't happy. He always said he survived his childhood.
I'm sorry, Clarice said, surprised. I didn't know. Was his father violent?
No, no, never.
Emily hesitated, thoughtful for a moment.
Dad's parents, my grandparents, Ralph and Avril, had what Dad described as a loveless marriage.
Clarice nodded, waiting to hear more.
When Dad was 5, he caught his mum crying. She told him, Daddy doesn't love me, he loves someone else. A few days later, she took Dad to a school friend's house for an afternoon in the garden. She was due to collect him at tea time, but it was evening when Ralph came. He told Colin his mum had gone away. She'd left.
How awful, Clarice said. It must have been a terrible shock.
And something that would have stayed with him all his life.
Yes, and worse still, Dad said he'd seen Avril the previous day in the garden talking to Ralph's business partner, Major Freddie Baxter. Everyone always referred to him as the Major. Avril was in tears and the Major was holding her hand.
She might have been confiding in him, Clarice said. If she'd found out about her husband's affair, perhaps she needed an adult shoulder. Confiding her troubles to a 5-year-old wouldn't have worked. Emily gave Clarice a knowing look.
The Major went missing the same day as Avril.
Ah, I see.
So he wasn't married?
Emily sipped her tea thoughtfully.
No, he was separated. His wife had left him a few weeks earlier.
Well, that does alter the picture. A bit coincidental, them going at the same time, Clarice said. Her interest stirred.
Grandpa said they had left together, but Dad never believed him. He said that his mum would have taken him with her.
Emily gave a half smile.
According to Dad, Avril was loving, gentle and shy, and she would never have just gone without even saying goodbye.
He didn't find out more, Clarice probed.
From Ralph, after the dust settled?
No, Avril was a taboo subject. Dad said if he ever talked about her leaving, or even mentioned her name, Grandpa went mad. Grandpa said that he'd lost 2 people on the same day. He thought of the Major as a close friend, the brother he'd never had.
And did Colin like the Major?
Very much. He'd thought the world of him until the day he disappeared with his mother.
Poor Ralph, and poor Colin. That's so sad. Clarice thought for a few minutes. What about Ralph's relationship? Who was he having an affair with?
Well, his girlfriend moved in about 4 months after Avril left. Her name's Tessa Dinkler. She and Grandpa had a daughter called Dawn, 12 years younger than Dad. She still lives with them at the manor.
So Colin had a half-sister.
Dad would never have described her like that. He told people he was an only child. They didn't grow up as siblings. Dad was sent away to boarding school when he was 12. Dawn was born a couple of months after he'd gone. After leaving school, he went off to university.
Clarice could not suppress the thought that Colin's dislike of his half-sibling might have been due to jealousy. He'd gone away, and Dawn had taken his place in the family home. He must have set tongues wagging with the locals, she said, meditatively. Ralph's wife left, and shortly afterwards the girlfriend moved in.
Yes,
Emily drew the word out.
My great-grandfather and great-great-grandfather were both known to have kept mistresses. It was something Grandpa thought amusing, but perfectly normal. My dad said that the Compton-Smythes saw themselves as red-blooded males. He thought they were hypocrites.
Really? Clarice was starting to see a different side to Colin.
Front row in church on Sunday with the family, and visits to the mistress during the week.
Well, I can see your dad's point. Clarice tactfully brought the conversation back to the matter in hand.
So you're waiting to hear from your grandfather about the funeral arrangements?
Emily nodded.
What about your mum? You said she lives in France.
She moved there 6 years ago, after the divorce.
Emily sounded matter-of-fact.
She was pregnant when she left. She had 2 sons by her French husband. When she left, I stayed here with Dad.
Will she come over for the funeral?
Good God! No chance!
Emily huffed.
She did give her condolences, but she said Colin is her past, She has her boys to think about.
But, Clarice thought, looking at Emily's indignant face, she also has a daughter who is now suddenly alone. Did you stay at Stone Fen Manor with your dad while you were a child?
We went for the weekend twice every year. I'm not sure if I'd call it ritual or duty. I was often curious, wondering what Avril, my grandmother, might have been like.
Emily paused in contemplation.
I'm not too fond of Tessa, or Dawn. I think Tessa sees me as competition.
Clarice looked at her, puzzled.
For Grandpa's affections. I took attention away from them. And then there's great Aunt Ernestine, Ralph's spinster sister, who's completely barking, and that was before she was diagnosed with dementia.
When was she diagnosed?
Within the last year,
Emily said after a moment of thought.
She has a heart condition too, but then she's nearly 80.
Clarice nodded, thinking that Emily was probably contemplating again how young her father had been when he died.
I should go.
She hesitated before asking, when is Jake coming?
He won't be.
Emily looked awkward.
I finished with him 2 days before I came home. I told you he was coming because I thought you were concerned about my being alone. I lied.
I am sorry, Emily.
Breaking up with your boyfriend and then your dad dying 2 days later,
Clarice said with sympathy.
Yeah, my timing was rubbish.
Emily cast her eyes downward. Are you going to be okay here on your own? There was a long silence. Clarice thought the girl was weighing something up.
Can I ask you a huge favour?
She said at last. Go on.
Grandpa said he'd organised the death certificate for the funeral director. I have to wait until I hear from him about a date. And I'm not up to doing anything about the bungalow or the things in it.
Probably too soon to think about all that. You only lost your dad yesterday.
Give yourself some time,
Clarice said gently. Emily nodded.
It's my first year at uni. I'd like to go back.
She pressed her fingers to her lips briefly, as if trying to hold back more tears.
That way I can be with my friends for a bit before the funeral.
That sounds like a good idea, Clarice encouraged her.
I need to speak to my tutors, let them know what's happened, why my assignments will be late.
Emily paused.
I don't suppose you would take the cats home with you for a couple of nights, 3 at the most. They've never been to a cattery.
Yes, if it helps, of course I will, Clarice said immediately.
Thank you so much, Clarice.
Emily's face had suddenly brightened, showing her natural beauty.
I don't want them rehomed. They're my last link to Dad. I just need a few days.
Good idea to be with friends, and you can't do much here anyway.
There is one other thing.
Emily twisted her face into a grimace.
I hope I'm not asking too much.
What is it? Clarice was intrigued.
You'll probably think it's a bit silly.
Try me.
It's about Avril, my grandmother.
Josephine wandered in yowling as Emily spoke, and she bent to scoop her onto her lap.
Dad never believed the story about his mum running away with the Major. He hoped he might find her one day, and about 10 years ago, he even paid a private detective agency to try and trace her.
No success?
Unfortunately not. Last night, I came across the box where Dad kept his mementos of his mother. It also has the agency's report.
Clarice nodded.
Would it be possible, while I'm in Nottingham, for you to go through it? Dad told me you had the sharpest mind of anyone he knew, and he said you are a bit of a sleuth.
Well, I'm very nosy and inquisitive, Clarice began.
Just give me an opinion. I don't expect anything else. It's half a century since they went missing, but if you could take a look?
Yes. Clarice spoke the word decisively. She found herself already fascinated by what Emily had told her.
Great.
Emily stood up, passing Josephine to Clarice.
I'll get the cat baskets first.
20 minutes later, the cats were in their baskets on the kitchen floor, and Clarice had a carrier bag full of their food. Emily came into the room carrying a small brown wooden box.
Here we are.
She opened the box to bring out 2 photographs.
This was Dad as a child with Avril.
Clarice looked at the photograph of Colin, at perhaps 4 or 5 years of age. He stood with his arms around the skirts of a pretty woman who was smiling, with one hand raised to shade her face from the glare of the sun. She had fair, wavy hair, and wore a white lacy blouse and a locket.
"The locket Avril is wearing is in the box, and this is my dad with Grandpa."
Emily passed the second black-and-white photograph to Clarice. Behind the family group, dwarfing them, stood an enormous, worn, but still majestic, stone Siamese cat in a sitting position, its paws lined up out in front. Clarice looked closely at the picture.
"Who are the others?"
Emily leant in to point.
"This is Grandpa and Avril, with Dad in front. This is Major Freddy and Great Aunt Ernestine. Probably it's Johnson behind the camera. He works for the family, does most of the cooking."
"What's his other name?" Clarice asked.
"I don't know. I've only ever known him as Johnson," Emily said. "Ralph's eyesight is poor, so Johnson drives him about. He does a lot in the house and instructs the cleaning lady who comes in weekdays and the gardener."
"And the two black Labradors?"
"Grandpa always has two black labs. It's a family tradition, that, and having Siamese cats."
"It sounds like a busy household. The stone Siamese is stunning."
"She's called Bellatrix, which is Latin for a female warrior," Emily said. "The first breeding pair of Siamese came to the UK in 1884. They were called Poe and Mia. Dad said my great-great-grandmother, Emily, my namesake, was bonkers about Siamese cats. And in 1890, she acquired a pair of kittens, descendants of the first breeding pair. Because she loved them so much, great-great-grandpa George said, when he commissioned the stonemason, that the stone cat's features had to be recognisable as being Siamese."
"Which is why the family continues to have that breed of cats. What an interesting history."
"Bellatrix stares out to the fens and beyond to the wash."
Emily warmed to telling the story.
"According to family legend, she guards the house and protects its inhabitants."
Clarice smiled, thinking that poor Colin didn't seem to have been overly protected in the course of his lifetime. After they'd talked for a further 10 minutes, Clarice made a move to leave. Emily helped her carry the cat baskets to the porch, though Clarice told her to stay indoors as she was still in her pyjamas. The sky had darkened with rain falling. It was clear from the puddles that it had set in some time ago.
"Thanks for coming,"
Emily hugged her.
"I appreciate it. And you will have a look through the things in Dad's box?"
"I will," Clarice promised. "And when you get back from Nottingham, you must come over to the cottage for lunch. We can talk more about it then." Clarice drove home, aware of Colin's cat in the back of the car. She had not raised the subject with Emily, but the younger woman's insistence that she intended to keep the animals was problematic. It was doubtful she could have them in her room in the hall of residence. It was something she would discuss with her the next time they met. She glanced at the brown wooden box on the seat next to her. She found it hard to stop her mind from roaming over the details Emily had given her about the Compton-Smith family. She realised she was itching to get home and explore the box's contents and the investigator's report. Chapter 4. Later, over a lunch of vegetable soup and homemade bread, Clarice told Bob and Sandra about her visit to Emily.
"Poor girl."
Sandra was sympathetic to Emily's plight.
"Dad dying so young and unexpectedly, and her mum, with a new family, not having time for her."
Clarice imagined that Sandra might be thinking about her own daughters, Susan and Michelle, and how awful it would have been if they'd ever been in that position. But Sandra's girls were now in their 40s, with half-grown children of their own.
"And then splitting up with the boyfriend," Sandra sighed.
Clarice nodded as she looked at her friend. In her 70s, Sandra was small and feisty, always beautifully turned out. Her makeup and every dyed black hair perfectly in place, and as usual, wearing bright pink lipstick.
"Don't forget it was Emily who did the dumping," Bob interrupted.
He was an inch taller and a year younger than his wife, rotund and with little hair.
"I can still feel sorry for her. She's not much more than a kid,
Sandra shot back.
We've got Colin's cats for a few days, Clarice interrupted. Although Emily did open up with me, she'll be happier with her uni mates.
You have a way of getting people to open up.
Sandra looked at Bob, who nodded.
And by the way, we're both in love with Sassy. What an old fusspot.
I love the way his front paws turn outwards, like the legs of an antique chair.
Bob demonstrated, making his hands into fists to mimic Sassy's.
He stamps and rumbles when I go in, like he's ready to argue. But when he's picked up, he goes into melting purr mode.
A lion in disguise.
He has a big personality, Clarice said.
I doubt you'll find anyone to take him, Sandra said. He'll be one of the stickers. Too old to rehome, and you and Rick said you couldn't take on any more yourselves.
If we can't find him a home, we'll have a rethink.
Rick might change his mind. Good luck with that,
Sandra rolled her eyes.
So, Bob put his elbows on the table to lean in.
When are you going to look through that box?
He glanced at his wife and winked. The three collectively turned their gazes to the wooden box that had been displayed on the dresser since Clarice's return.
I'll have a look later today.
It's not like you to wait,
Bob teased.
You're usually onto something immediately.
Have you still not sorted out those business accounts?
Nope.
Clarice shook her head ruefully.
If there's a mystery, it's sure to pull you in. But it all happened too long ago, darling.
Sandra sounded dubious.
They'll all be dead. You won't get to the bottom of it after 50 years.
Bob nodded. Sandra's right. And if the detective agency couldn't find out what happened to Avril, you'll probably be wasting your time.
I promised Emily I'd look at the stuff in the box.
Clarice shrugged.
I'll go through what's in there. It's my own time I'm wasting.
After they had cleared the table and washed the bowls and plates, Clarice followed her friends outside, chatting until they left, then set out to walk the boundary of the garden with the dogs. The day had brightened up and the rain had stopped, with the sun splitting through the clouds. The dogs moved ahead of her across the grasses of the wildflower meadow, happy, like Clarice, to be outside. Back in the cottage, she headed upstairs to the study to catch up on phone messages. Blue and Jazz, squashed together on the small sofa at one end of the room, Jazz, the smaller of the two, resting her head in the centre of Blue's back. The room was spick and span, having undergone a tidy and a deep clean a few days earlier. After finishing the phone calls, Clarice sat in front of her computer, working through columns of figures. She needed to get all the paperwork for her ceramics business in order before sending the accounts to Douglas Baines, whom she'd used for many years. Her mind returned to Colin Compton-Smythe. Douglas was in his mid-60s, and she'd often thought that when he retired, she would ask Colin to take over as her accountant. It was not to be. Her eyes kept creeping to the dark green folder with Brown, Davidson and Simpson in black letters on the cover. Inside, the first page was headed Client, Colin Compton-Smythe, and below, Purpose of Investigation, Missing Persons. With an effort, she pulled her eyes and thoughts back to her accounts. She generally sent the paperwork for the previous year's income from her ceramics business in June. This year, time had somehow spooled out, and she knew she must complete this tedious task today. Douglas expected to receive the accounts before the end of the week. The sooner she got it done, the sooner she could read the investigator's report. Blue started to snore, a deep, contented rumble. The wind was getting up. Clarice could hear it whispering. Outside the window, the clouds moved and leaves danced. Ignoring all the distractions, she switched her total concentration to the accounts. Over 2 hours later, as A4 sheets of paper collected in the tray of the printer, she sighed with relief. She put the paperwork, bank statements and receipts into a large manila envelope and addressed it to Douglas. She would take it into Castlewick the following day and drop it in at his office. Downstairs, while the kettle boiled for a cup of mint tea, she opened the door to allow the dogs to wander in and out for a few minutes.
Taking her tea into the sitting room, she flopped down onto the sofa to open the dark green folder. Then, with a change of heart, put it back into the box and brought out the battered black notebook that was underneath it. Opening it, she smiled as she recognised Colin's neat handwriting, remembering the deep blue fountain pen ink he'd been fond of using. There were several pages of notes under the heading Investigative Agency. They started with a list, possibly written before the initial meeting with the investigator, to remind himself of questions to ask and what his requirements were. Tracing the whereabouts of Avril? Tracing the whereabouts of Major Freddie Baxter? Did they leave Stone Fen Manor together? If finding them proves to be impossible, follow the trail as far as possible. Janice Baxter, wife of Freddie, left before her husband. Her trail might lead to the Major. Find more information. Contact Avril's friends. There should be no contact with my family members at Stone Fen Manor. The notes then continued with an account of his first meeting with Dennis Simpson, who had assured him that the agency had a high success rate and that he would be given a detailed account of all the time spent on the investigation. Clarice flicked slowly through. The next list appeared to be memories of Avril. Further on, there were addresses. As she turned the pages, there was the sound of a car engine outside. Both dogs ran to the door in a frenzy of barking. She switched on the outside light. It was dark, with day creeping into evening. "Rick," she said, as he climbed out of his car while being welcomed home by the dogs, "you're early."
"Don't sound so surprised. It's gone six, though I suppose that's early by my standards."
He grinned as he followed her inside, looking forward to a comfortable evening. Later, after dinner, having moved into the sitting room, they sat in companionable silence for a few minutes. The only sounds were the fire crackling, spreading its warmth. Blue and Jazz lay sleeping, back to back on the hearthrug. Reposing around the room, on chairs, the windowsill, and along the back of the sofa, were five of the seven family cats. Rick had told Clarice about his day, with little more to add on the murder case.
"You haven't told me. How did you get on with Emily?"
he asked. Clarice repeated everything Emily had told her. "Have you gone through the report and what's in the box?"
"I ran out of time. I had to finish the hated accounts. I've only read through what I suspect Colin was going to instruct the investigator to look into. I'll get stuck in properly tomorrow morning."
"Sounds like your sort of mystery," Rick smiled.
"Bob and Sandra thought that after 50 years it would be unsolvable."
"Well, I agree with them, but that's not going to stop you trying."
"That sounds like a thumbs up, not the usual disapproval."
"I'm never disapproving, quite the opposite. I'd like to think I've always supported you."
Rick sounded defensive.
"You always help."
Clarice gave her sweetest smile.
"I know. Eventually."
Rick appeared to reassess his position.
"I'm generally cautious because the puzzles you delve into have brought you into contact with some unpleasant characters."
He paused momentarily.
"But I don't think something that happened half a century ago will be dangerous. No mad murderers lurking in the shadows. Avril and her Major have probably been dead for years."
"Quite possibly," Clarice agreed. "It might be that when I've gone through the box and the report, I'll feel that it's a no-go, a complete dead end."
"That's for tomorrow."
Rick stood up, and the dogs, reading the signs, preceded him to the door.
"While you take the girls around the garden, I'll do my last check-in at the cat barn," Clarice said.
"I'll come with you," Rick offered.
"Are you sure? It's getting late. You're up early tomorrow."
Clarice spoke gently.
"Don't you want to get to bed?"
"Let's do it together, Clarice.
Anyway, I've not met Sassy yet."
After taking a turn around the garden with Blue and Jazz, they headed into the barn, leaving Sassy until last. As Clarice walked towards the cat, it came at pace to meet her. But on reaching her, the animal let out a yowl of joy and ran straight past her to Rick. Rick stared down. The cat gazed up, giving its best vocal offerings, half shout, half purr.
I had to pick him up to get that reaction, Clarice said, green-eyed.
He's got good taste.
Rick bent to scoop the cat up. Sassy immediately tucked his head into Rick's neck, putting his paws on either side.
I think you're his chosen one,
Clarice smiled. He has the most amazing old gentleman set of handlebar whiskers. They curve to meet in the front.
Old cats are beautiful in ways not always obvious.
I hope you can find him a good home.
You know we can't take another one into the house.
Rick gently rubbed his fingers down Sassy's back.
Yes, I know.
Back at the cottage, Rick went to bed while Clarice headed for the sitting room to open the brown box. It had turned into a strange week. Sassy, Colin's death, and the meeting with Emily. Taking out the two photographs, she held them under the bright circle of the table lamp to examine them more closely. Ralph and the Major were both in their prime. Ralph, broad-chested and rugged. The Major, half a head taller, elegant and handsome with chiselled features. Looking at each of the faces in turn, she ruminated over where Avril and the Major might have gone on that fateful day 50 years ago. Her eyes finally came to rest on Colin, a child, but recognisable as the man she'd known. They had spent numerous hours together over the last 11 years. She had known him first as a pupil, then as a friend, and their discussions had covered many aspects of life. They'd laughed together often. She'd considered him a decent person, kind, funny and thoughtful. She felt a stab of profound sadness.
All those internal hidden scars. You carried such misery for most of your life.
She spoke quietly to the image of the child in the photograph. I might not be able to get to the bottom of it, but I promise I'll try. Chapter 5. The following morning, after Rick had left for work, and Sandra and Bob had taken over the cat duties, Clarice took in the view from her study window as she unpacked the contents of the box onto her desk. A slash of white along the horizon topped an angry black sky. The wind moved the trees in a frantic jig, and the first drops of rain hit the window. As she glanced at the items in front of her, the phone rang.
Clarice, hi, it's Emily.
Her voice sounded more upbeat than the last time they'd spoken.
How are you?
Much better, thank you. Are Napoleon and Josephine all right?
Perfect,
Clarice said.
I heard from Grandpa. Dad's funeral has been arranged for Thursday of next week at Sealsby Village Church.
Clarice heard the tension in Emily's voice.
Well, I'm glad he's got a date.
I'm meeting one of my lecturers in about 15 minutes, but I'm going to be cheeky and ask if you'd mind my returning to pick the cats up on Saturday rather than tomorrow.
No problem, Clarice said. You did say it might be 3 nights. If you're coming on Saturday, have you time to join Rick and me for lunch? It'll probably only be soup, bread and cheese.
Brilliant. I'd love to meet your husband, and you can tell me what you think about that report, if you've managed to take a look.
About 12:30, then? We can talk over lunch.
I'll see you then.
Clarice returned her attention to the items from the box. The locket, a postcard, the green folder from the investigative agency, and the notebook.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.